Hello everyone, welcome.
Hi there, welcome back.
Hi guys, today is a great day. As you can see by my shirt, white and red, this is Polish flag. Today we have a holiday of the Polish flag celebration in Poland. So great that you are all here with me to celebrate this, and we can talk about the history of Poland and our flag and whatnot. Ah, wait, this is Conqueror's Blade Steam, sorry. I need to switch something up quickly. Okay, yeah. So, Conqueror's Blade, Group C players, CB, welcome. How are you feeling today?
Yeah, pretty good. Not as good as you on your national holiday, but pretty good. It's a great day. Sun is shining and we got great teams today ready for us. So I'm excited.
Yeah, definitely. And as you might know, or not yet, because I have not tell you, but you might have anticipated this by how the previous ones the tournament, right? Like the tournament days, the group stages, we have one less team. Hooray!
Easier for us.
Yes, easier for us, and I guess more time to enjoy you after the tournament for all of you as well. Unfortunately, Russian Village Boys were not able to make it to the playoff. So today we will be having Endgegner and Pondguard fighting each other. So definitely very interesting teams, especially that we have seen them in other tournaments as well as Aritournament 1, right, CB?
Yeah, exactly. These are two of the teams that are probably the most anticipated for us. They've played in basically every tournament that's going on. They are also playing in the core tournament that's currently going on Fridays. They played, like you said, in our tournament one, but they also play in other international tournaments. And they've also faced off against each other quite a few times as well. So definitely very experienced team that we are very excited to see. With DTI or Ergo as well, when they were going to join this group, we had three teams that were probably going to be like top four for the tournament for sure. But now we got Endgegner and Pondguard to fight for the final spots, and we're going to see what's going to happen, definitely.
Indeed, and as per every stream, we are going to introduce you shortly first to how the tournament goes, what are the rules, and all the information you need to know to enjoy the tournament as much as we do. Right now on the screen, you can see the schedule for the whole tournament. So this is six next Sundays. Right now we are in the middle, I guess, right? We have two middles, Group C and Group D will be two middles. So this 2nd May, we have Group C. Next week, we have Group D. After that, we have quarterfinals, and then we have semifinals and final game. So a lot ahead today, and a lot of us ahead of us as well in the upcoming Sundays. So remember to join us next week. Most probably, like 99%, we will also be starting a little bit later, so basically same time as today, due to one of the teams from Group B, from Group D, also being the American team. And if they will advance further on, probably their matches also we will be, you know, either we will be having them play later on today, later on in given day, so that they can get some sleep, or we'll move the whole tournament day fully an hour later. So we will see. Follow our official Aritournament Discord to catch on all the latest updates and be up to date with everything. Okay.
Exactly. I hope the Americans have prepared their coffee, General. I know you needed it last time, but they are going to need it even harder today.
Yeah. Especially that we have seen already on the tournament server some players exchanging some jokes around, and apparently in Pondguard team there are some people from both East Coast and West Coast, right? And, for the guys who are furthest away from us, it's 5 a.m. in the morning currently, so quite hardcore to wake up on such an early time and, you know, get up to the speed and be as good as you can, right? To compete on the tournament level, so we will see how it go, I guess. All right. Let's move on then quickly before we go to the whole tournament information and so on. Let's discuss as well about the betting, because as every week there is going to be a betting competition. So basically before the first game starts, you can bet on which team out of these two you think will advance with first place. How you do this? Exclamation mark bet on chat. You write it and then bot will respond you with some information on how to enter. The entries are already open. I can see already one person have provided their vote. So basically, yeah, exclamation mark bet on chat and you will have all the information over there. And what are we fighting for today is 200 sovereigns. So I like to use this small amount of sovereigns, to be honest, the most for the unit quest, right? CB, if you have unit quest to unlock berserkers or shield maidens and you have this one task, which is like you hate this game mode or whatever, right? And there is like halfway done and you just cannot go and do this and this is your last one. You can spend some of these sovereigns to unlock the remaining progress. So
yeah, exactly. I think I might join this bet as well because I definitely would like to have some sovereigns in my backpack.
Feel free to. Everyone who is not official My Games content creator can join, no problem. So
exactly.
Feel free to do so. Exclamation mark bet on chat and over there all the information. You just need to provide your nickname and pretty much vote and that's pretty much it. And we have also a subscriber. Hi Vero, thank you very much for sub. Welcome to the Doge family, happy to see you here on the stream, joining up. Come on, hype up some doges for Vero. And let's go to the rules. So, TB, what can you tell us?
They should be familiar for most people, right? But we will go over them once more. In this tournament, we have a few special rules that are not being used in any other tournaments. And I think they make it very exciting. We've seen great games so far. So we will be seeing no T5 units, no Golden Calf, no Pavlais, no Falconettis, just purple, blue, green and gray units, and so it's very infantry focused. People can play the seasonal units as well, so you can see armigers, berserkers, for example, that have been played quite a bit. There's also no artillery allowed to place, so there will be artillery already on the maps, right, on top of the walls and on the ground as well, but there will be no additional artillery being allowed by both teams. And it's very important because if a team does use it, they get banned, which we've seen a week ago, where the tiebreaker was lost by Lamaland because they used an artillery piece by accident. Then there are no doctrines allowed for either teams, and we also do not play with the runes fully. Teams can play one piercing doctrine rune, the green one, but no other runes are allowed. So it's just the units and the heroes. They are all equal, and they have to fight it out with themselves. And then all players have 3 lives per game, so if they die 3 times, they are out of the game completely, along with the units, which means that if you die 3 times, you are putting your team in a great disadvantage. We've not seen this happen too many times over the past few weeks, but it does happen a little bit, I would say. And we have seen that it can impact the game in a big way, especially during our tournament 1, where I think it was Endgegner that lost 3 or 4 players. And didn't have like 200 units to play with. So it can be very big in a tournament.
Yeah, especially if some, you know, all the teams, considering that there is 15 versus 15, right? You have 30 people on the battlefield. There is always going to be at least 1, 2, even more people, right? Who are kind of like, you know, hot-blooded, right? They like to jump into the middle of the action. They like to be in the tip of the spear of the front line, right? They like to be always up front, playing very aggressively, very offensively, and you know, there's always going to be someone like that. And for the team and the captains, if they can contain them and release them at the precious, you know, at the exact time, at the exact spot, this can be beneficial. But if they will not control them good enough, right, it might end up, you know, problematic, right, as we have seen.
Absolutely. It might backfire. And we've seen last week, for the first time, Dual Blades, right, being played in the tournament. We know that they can single out heroes. What do you think? Can we expect more Dual Blades or Muskets to kill heroes and kill specific players, perhaps?
I think that trend is going on, but there is less and less heavy armor and more medium and light. I believe first day we have not seen or maybe seen like one or two people in medium armor only, and then next day we've seen already a few light armors popping up, right? This time maybe even more coming into the fight, especially the dual blade last time played very well. He died, I believe, only one time and killed like three heroes, so this might be indeed very beneficial if used properly. But at this tournament stage, where people are playing very, you know, very concentrated gameplay, everyone is, you know, following orders very strictly, it might be hard to find an opening for dual blade. So ranged weapons, they are definitely safer, but also have you know, less firepower at the end to try to do something like that. So we will see. I know in Endgame there that there are at least two very good musket players. So I would say more medium armors, but if there will be any light armor, happy to see it.
Exactly.
Okay, so now we can discuss a little bit about the group's phases, how they will go. So there were, at the beginning of the tournament, 12 teams divided into four groups. We were supposed to fight 6 games in each group, right? So we have 4 groups, 6 games in each group. We decided to do it like that because we wanted to give everyone equal opportunity to test themselves both in attack and in defense. So this is very, like, I guess, crucial compared to previous ARI tournament or even some other tournaments, right? You have to prove yourself on the both ends of the wall where you will be fighting for. So this is important difference. Today we will have only 2 teams. As said earlier, unfortunately, Russian Village Boys didn't make it. So we'll have 2 teams. So we will see 2 games on a siege, 1 attack and 1 defense. And then depending if there will be tied, we will be playing field battle tiebreaker. So far in all previous groups, we had similar situation where we had only 2 teams and all of them ended up with field battle. So yeah, the field battle is very, very intensive match. We'll see if it will go over there as well today. So, CB, are you fine with that, with the amount of games, or would you prefer to have all 3 teams and all 6 siege games, plus then also potential tiebreakers?
Yeah, I mean, we've had so much fun with the tiebreakers being played in Group A and B last 2 weeks. I think they were a great way to break the tie that the games that teams had, and we've seen that they are, like, both groups were pretty equal, so we are still excited to see who's going to win out during the final stages. But I would have loved to see DTI Russian Village Boys play today, because I think those 3 teams are so exciting to look at in the tournament scene for Conqueror's Blade. But yeah, I think this is still a great way to see 2 very, very good teams from EU and NA. Maybe I would have preferred to even have a best of 5 with these 2 teams already make it to like a final, because they can be so good. But I think this is still a great way to fight it out.
Sure. And then I guess it also allows us to have some additional time and space for fun stuff like deathmatches at the end, right? So we'll see if we'll be able to pull in some players at the end of the day as well for this today. But for now, let's move into the final bracket.
Yeah, the final bracket consists of 2 weeks, right? The next one is in 3 weeks, the first one with quarterfinals. There will be 8 teams that are going out of groups. We know 4 teams already from Group A and B. Group A will play against Group C. So after today, you will have our first couple of quarterfinals finished or decided for who is going up against who. And next week, we will have Group D play, and then we will know all of our quarterfinals. It will be a best of 3 in the quarterfinals. Same for the third place match and the final that will be on the same day in the final week. So those will be our final 2 weeks of very exciting gameplay for Conqueror's Blade. I'm looking forward. How about you?
Yeah, as well. I mean, the final being best of 3, it's a little bit different approach than what we have right now, especially considering that this will be a lottery not only on the maps but also on the start site, right? So potentially, if we will go to 3rd game, there will be 1 team who will be playing twice on the same side. And this actually can be crucial thing, because some of the teams, like we heard yesterday, I believe it was the Nexus at the beginning, who said that they are very offensive team and they prefer to play on the attack, right? So there are teams who are good at defense and they really like the defense, but when you put them on attack, right, they are playing very standard game, not coming up with some crazy stuff which can surprise your enemy. And even though they try their best, and sometimes they, you know, get quite far away with their skill and their team play, still the whole strategy and tactic can be a bit lackluster in some departments, right? So depending on, you know, which team will randomly be chosen to play two times in attack, this can be, you know, groundbreaking for some of the teams. Or, you know, maybe they will use the experience they had from group stages and maybe also even previous tournaments, right? And especially that all of the matches we do are recorded, and then you can rewatch them and so on. You know, you can also observe your enemy, study what they are doing, and this can bring up really many different outcomes at the end. So cannot wait for this to see how much it will differ compared to the group stage.
Yeah, absolutely. And we can also see teams switching it up, right? I mean, attack can be the best defense. We've seen teams sally out of the gate, making it a field battle outside. So we'll see. Maybe teams decide to take a different approach.
Definitely. Okay, last thing to tell you about is maps. So for the maps, we have had 5 maps, which were chosen pretty much by the tournament organizers to be played on, and then we gave up vote ban system to all the team captains. Out of these 5 maps, Dasuo Fort and Valley Fortress were banned to not be used at all during the group stage. So we have Walfort, Kura Castle, and Harbor City available only. Previously, we have seen Walfort and Harbor City, so very different maps, you know, they're a lot of buildings on one, right? Just a wall pretty much on other one, right? A lot of places for cavalry on one, a lot of flanking opportunities on and places to hide on the second one. So we will see if today we will complete the lucky 3, lucky strike, or whatever you want to call it, and we'll get to Kura Castle, or maybe we'll replay one of the maps that were played either on group A or B. But how the maps are chosen, they are randomly chosen around 5 to 6 minutes before the game. I will be switching in a moment to the German cast to show you this, and we will be choosing the map which teams will play on both of their games today. So, CB, I will have to excuse you for a moment.
Yeah, go ahead.
And switching to German cast. Hello. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. What's up? Are you hyped?
So, yeah, we decided to go on the stream call. That's just making it easier for me to balance the sound between Becky and me. And yeah, we are hyped for the first game, and we want to see who is on which map we will play the first and second round.
Mm-hmm. So okay. Are we waiting from... Yeah, I am, but are we waiting from Alucard?
May I ask him? Yeah, he's mute.
Okay.
Forgot to unmute me here.
So, we have one opportunity, 1 out of 3 to see a new map, right?
Yes.
Oh, we're going to... Yay!
Okay, we ready? Then I... And it's Harbor City again.
Harbor
I actually like Harbor City more than Kura Castle, but we will see how they play on it.
We'll see what teams prefer.
So Harbor City it is?
Yes, Harbor City.
It is Harbor City.
Who's attacking?
I believe and Gegner are first attacking.
Sexy. See you guys.
See ya.
Yeah, see you. Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Yeah, welcome back. So Harbor City is chosen as a map for today. Maybe you have been able to see it, maybe not, because I forgot again. And the last time I switched the lottery wheel, I mean, you heard it on the stream, it was
heard. I heard. Yeah.
Basically, Harbor City is going to be played once more, so very interesting.
Yeah, this is very interesting. We've already seen Endgegner play on Harbor City. They did a pretty good defense on it against Eden. Against Goblins. And they also got sallied out by Goblins and lost that one. So they also had that attack and defense on Harbor City before. Quite recently, like just 1 or 2 weeks ago. And we know that Pondguard also in an NA team. Goblins is the other NA team that we will see next week. They both like to play with Kev, both like to sally out sometimes. Mm-hmm. So this is already an interesting like expectation that both teams have of each other in terms of what they can expect.
Sure. I mean, considering that Endgegner is attacking first, this might bring up some interesting strategies. Because Endgegner team, from what I know about them and how I watched them, also how they played in the first Ari tournament, is they're very offensive, right? They like playing aggressively, they like being very aggressive in their pushes, in their tactics, in their units choices as well. So if we have a map which is quite wide and there is quite far distances from all the key points, this can go either way, in my opinion. If they will go too aggressive and overestimate Pondguard, they might end up in a situation where they lose most of their units, even maybe few heroes during a push, and they are placed in front of very hard decision. They either need to call it a day and, you know, go back and regroup and not lose anything more. This will waste a lot of time, as said, a lot of ground to cover, right? As well, as you said, if NA teams like to sally out with horses, they can also cut them out. So this can be potentially very, very problematic. Or are they going to continue the push, hope for the best, wait for their team to spawn, especially that the first spawn is quite fast when you die first time. So you know, maybe the wall push will not be that problematic. But moving further on, if they will not be able to capture any of the pluses too fast, it might go. It might be very problematic in the long run.
Yeah, totally. And like it's not like Pondguard only uses Kev, right? We've seen them destroy turrets, like siege towers, with rotten marksmen on defense. So we know that they can play with infantry as well, of course. I mean, they've also done a few of the quickest games of the tournament on attack. Of course, they have to defend first. So we know that they are very strong. They have very coordinated pushes. They know how to play Numcons and perhaps the Kalian Militia that we have seen as perhaps the flavor of the tournament so far. So, yeah, both teams are strong and we can expect a lot of them. I'm curious to see if they will play like a full Armiger line. We've seen Armigers, of course, being the main Kev, but we've also seen how it can be very vulnerable because these teams know how to counter the Kev from Armigers.
Yeah, so as we have just a few minutes left before the match, the lobby is open, by the way. I see you already in. Cool. So players will be joining shortly and we'll be starting in the match in a few minutes. So let's talk a little bit more in detail about the teams. Unfortunately, DTI is out, so that's what you can see right now on the screen. Even though no matches were played, we can see all Endgegner and Pondguard already have a few wins here. This is just to make the scores appropriately displayed. And this is also a little bit of shame that the DTI couldn't make it because they are EU1 team, right? So if they would be in, we would have EU1, EU2, and NA. So very nice mishmash, very nice mix. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, they are out, so let's focus right now on Entgegner and Conquer. Guys, if you don't know, Entgegner is coming from EU2. They are coming from a house with the same name, Entgegner, and they are international house. Also, they have international lineup here coming to the tournament, consisting of German, French, Spanish, Portuguese, Slovenian, Serbian, Iranian, Swiss, Austrian, and even some Polish guys. There might be, as we have some small, slightly outdated information, there might be even more nationalities being represented on the tournament, but hopefully we'll be able to fix the information coming further. Compared to the Pond Guard, this is a little bit different, considering that they are American and Canadian only, right? So you have all people speaking English as their main language. You have all people working together in same time zone or similar time zones, right? Because North America have a few time zones, but you know, very similar thinking, very similar cultures. And we will see if this will be reflected in their play style. So they are from NA, the Pond Guard team, and they like competitive gameplay. They're aiming for first place. So gonna be very interesting, considering that Entgegner also is going to aim for the top. Both of the teams are have quite a lot of achievements when it comes to the territory wars and the normal gameplay. So they have conquered a few capital cities a few times. Pond Guard have held the main objective for last 4 seasons, and Entgegner, I believe, for last 2 seasons. So this is indeed very, very interesting stuff. And definitely considering that they also played in many, many, many tournaments, considering or putting here in line the official Booming Games tournament that was hosted some time back, Core Tournament currently, and Aritournament 1 as well. This is going to be a great matchup against them. So, CB, what else can you tell us?
Yeah, it's not just the teams that have been performing great, their players are also excellent, right? We are seeing players that are like really commonly placed in the top 100 of ranked battles. I know you and I play ranked. We play each other, I think it was last day or 2 days ago.
Yeah.
It was a pretty fun game. You stumped me quite a bit there. I think you might have targeted me. But we know that these players are really good. Players like Susno, he was top 8. I think he's back down to top 50 right now. But also on the NA side, we got like Toad King, Pian, Giotto. These are all like so, so very good at this game. Pian had the highest level for the Pond Guard team with 2,720. And their current rank for Toad King was 5th, Giotto 7th, Pian 9th. So these guys are so, so good at this game. And you can see it also in the stats, right? Giotto averaged 137 unit kills. That's pretty good. We've seen those numbers from other great players from other teams, but they can do it as well. And Ripcats with 10 hero average kills. And yeah, he's here as well today. So I wonder what class he plays. But I would look forward to a game where he gets 10 hero kills. Let's see it. Let's see it happen. So yeah, both teams have excellent players. And for Entgegner, we're looking at the Alpha Poo, but also at Susno, of course. He's their captain. He's saying he's not their star player, but he's really good as well. And also Magner, he's been the MVP as well as Novelty in quite a few games. So they're all like very good players. Excellent. Yep.
Sure. And yeah, I mean, considering the statistics you told us about, especially ranked games, those very often reflect not only the skill of a player, but also his attitude, right? To get to the top of the rankings, you need to be a calm person. You need to not worry that much about your mistakes, about your issues, about how well or how bad your team plays, right? You need to be above that. And considering that we will be seeing a few games today, this can be crucial if one of the teams will lose the first one, right? You need to, you know, come with the straight thinking, with the clear mind to the second game, not worry about what happened too much, right? Of course, consider mistakes, fix them, work on them, and be better at the second game. But you know, many of these non-gameplay skills that lead you to the top of the leaderboards can also be used here very, very well. So we'll see where it goes. For now, I have a short update for you. Seems like from the PondGuard team, there is one or two players missing. So we will be waiting a few more minutes for them to come. As they are American team, this is quite strange for them to play so early, right? Especially that, you know, if you are on the East Coast, it's not that problematic because it's only 6 hours earlier, so you have 9 a.m. over there, I believe. But West Coast, we heard, 5 or 6 in the morning. It can be quite hardcore for the players to wake up and, you know, play at such an early time. So we'll be extending the time countdown for a moment. We'll wait a few minutes for the players to come. Yeah, I see Slimboss, welcome. Hi guys, by the way. Thank you for the follows, Bokat, Natrix. Welcome, welcome. Exclamation mark bet on the chat. If you write it, you can still enter the betting competition. This additional 10 minutes you can use very well, because I see we have just a few entries right now. And let me tell you that most of them are on one team only, so there is very big chance to be you know, to predict correctly who will be the winner of the first seat of the group C. And you can do that by writing exclamation mark bet and then joining through the form. On the chat I can see, hi Lolbrok, yeah, you liked my bird the most when it was first time. Actually, it's a funny story, because I decided that for all four group stages I will do different beard hairstyles, right? So first time I had multiple things plotted in. So last week it was full open, and right now it's just one single circle, so different.
So maybe we should do a vote for the finals to see what people like the most.
the best ones. I mean,
we can put up pictures next week.
I mean, yeah, I don't know about that, but good information about my appearance in Poland. They are lifting down a little bit the coronavirus closure stuff, right? So I will be finally able to visit the hairdresser.
Nice.
Next Monday. No, not upcoming Monday, but in a week, actually. There's so long queue that, oh my god. Yeah, it's Adam, I see. Exclamation mark bet. Yes, guys, exclamation mark bet to enter. And Lolbrok asking if we can get a Viking chant. I would be very happy to do so. Unfortunately, my dog just went to sleep after bugging me for last 2 hours, so please no. So CB, you need to do it.
Let's go.
Okay. Sounds like Charge of Berserkers. So good.
Yeah, we might bring that up as well. Let's good stuff. See some Berserkers. I've seen some great plays from them last week.
Yeah, and considering previous groups A and B, how many strange units did we have?
I don't know. Like, some units that are expected to be strange, I don't find strange anymore. Like Sicily and Militia, they've become popular, I think. I don't know what you think about them. But they're certainly a unit that I think most people consider strange. They are not being played in siege battles quite often. I love to play them. I just did a game with them today and got 80 unit skills. So is that one unit that you find strange, perhaps, to see?
Yeah, no. Actually, the current Militia is the only one unit where a lot of people, you know, just spit on them, as old meme was saying. but they don't like them. People usually don't like them, and this is for a reason. They deal not that much damage. But if you play them to their strength, they can be quite useful, especially considering that in many of the sieges, like the standard game sieges, of course, people are often pushing like first wave, for example, with you know, not that great units, right? So you have just like one or two or three purple or gold, and most of them are like blue or whatever units. And for lower units who doesn't have fire resistance, they are very, very good. And they are good in one thing, they are good in dealing a lot of damage spread across many units. So the more grouped push enemy is coming with, the better they can perform. And this is what we can see in pretty much any competitive gameplay. You need to be, you need to work as a team, you need to work as one unit, you need to come in one place very fast and just, you know, push through. If not, you will be just taken down by better team play of enemy. So this is very good counter to this typical gameplay on the tournament servers where you have to group, right? It's similar when you play a musket on the bombs, right? So full strength musket with bombs, you don't deal tons of damage as expect this one rune, right, which was bugged for a moment, but it is fixed now. Other than that, you don't deal that much damage, but you deal very far area overtime damage. And you know, if the enemy is waiting for 30 seconds preparing their push, waiting for more units to come and so on, and you can throw two times all the three bombs, you can take, you know, let's say like three or four units standing in one place, you can take them all to half HP or even lower, and they push with half HP units? No, usually you go and back and heal, right? And then you have like three or four people left. So this is an extension to that. So if we would see a musket player playing bombs and the Kalyan Militia used on top, he could really do a lot of damage. So that's definitely not that strange in my opinion.
Yeah, I think I agree. Like you said, it kind of depends on what kind of battle we're talking about. Like the tournament scene, like you said, has a lot of grouping. Teams are very joined in their pushes. So you see a different meta evolve. Like the Kali Militia we saw last week from Lamaland, they had a very diverse team. Not just Stalwart, Spikes, Fort Rachos, but they brought a lot of ranged. And that was very effective in their defense against Kittens. So it's very dependent on the environment that you play in. We know, of course, when you play TWs, that you see a lot of Kev, right? And then you expect more Imperial Pikes as counters, perhaps, or even more Kev. So you see different units depending on what you play. And if you only play Siege Battles, then you might see very different units, and you might see more diversity. And also because some players like to play certain units, but they will not bring them to this tournament because they might not be as effective. So, so far, I think in this tournament, we've not seen extremely surprising units. We've seen Javelins that maybe stood out a little, but teams have already acknowledged that they can be very effective if a supply is close by on certain maps, right? They are great in killing heroes, but also deal a lot of damage to units as well.
Sure.
So, yeah. Sums it up.
Yeah, for the latest updates on the game, we are still waiting for these two players from Pontgard. Seems like they have some trouble reaching them, so might be a bit problematic. And in the background, we are talking about some ideas to fix this. So the team leaders will be probably talking in a moment about playing, evening out the numbers. So maybe we'll play 14 versus 14. And actually this is, yeah, we have one of the casters, the Spanish caster, Professor Alucard, probably will join Pontgard. So nice. We'll have live stream from one of our caster team joining them to the fight, and Endgegner team being very honorable, they will remove one of the players so from their lineup, so it will be 14 versus 14. Seems nice. Like that's the current update. Unless CB, you want to play as well?
Yeah, I want to play for sure. I don't mind playing. I love it.
Yeah, so right on the caster's chat.
We'll talk about it. Hang on.
So we could make it then 15 versus 15.
Zone, so we'll see, yeah. Let's find out.
Okay. So, seems like you and Bergliebe, so the German co-caster will be right now joining, so you guys together will be helping the Pond Guard team. Okay, so if that will be able to put this up, then we'll have full 15 versus 15 fight.
Yeah, let me figure out if they have got a Discord where I can join.
Yeah, so seems like Ari is working on this right now. Okay. Yeah, good. So Pond Guard and TTD and Samuel, I believe, is from Ragnarok, right? As well.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. So we'll have
right? Yeah.
EU2/NA team versus EU2 team.
This time it's EU that has got to save the day for NA.
Yeah, so CB, considering you are asked to play in the tournament and you knew about it from 30 seconds, how do you feel? Stressed?
Well, this is a pre-game interview now, amazing. Yeah, I'm so excited to play with these experienced guys. We've known each other for quite a long time. No, I'm joking. Yeah, looking forward to it. I hope I will not bring shame to my house and to EU too. And I'll do my best.
We'll yeah. Also, do you think that your very deep knowledge of many teams, how they play, what is their strategy, how they utilize their units, what are their movements? You know, you observed a lot of tournaments, getting all these statistics and all this data to present to our viewers. Do you think this will be your key strength bringing this as to the fight?
That's interesting. It might be like I think I know some inside information about Endgegner by watching all their games about how they play. So yeah, maybe I can reinforce Pond Guard with some good information. Although I do assume that they have seen all those games as well because they've been playing in those tournaments. But yeah, maybe I can bring them some. We'll see. I'll let you know after the games what I could bring to them.
All right. Yeah, so I guess I will do the talking, I will do the walking, and then we can meet after all three games, I guess. Unless you will crash Endgegner, or you will be crushed by Endgegner in two games, and then there will be no tiebreaker needed. Okay, so have you received the link to the...
I don't know, hang on, I'm gonna close this down. Where should I have the link? I'll message Pion. All right, so...
Okay, good luck, my friend.
Yeah, thank you.
See you later, bye-bye. All right, guys, so... Seems like we have a very interesting thing coming up ahead of us. My co-caster, who is usually sitting over there, right there, is right now missing, and he is missing for a good reason. He is going to join Pond Guard team, and he will be playing along with a German co-caster, Samuel. They will be playing with Pond Guard. Unfortunately, Pond Guard, two of their players couldn't make it. They, you know, coming from NA, they have vast time difference, right? It's very big. Guys who live in the West Coast, they have like 6 a.m. or something like that for them, and it might be problematic if someone works late or whatever, right, to join in on such a short notice as well. So yeah, seems like Pond Guard having right now 13 players and 2 streamers, or co-casters, I should say better, in team, will be ready in a moment. So we'll be starting shortly. Very interesting. I did not expect something like that to happen. There is a lot of good luck, have fun being right now placed on the chat. So both teams in very good moods, both teams in very high spirits. Definitely interesting to see what they will bring. As you know already, a short reminder, we will be playing on Harbor City, both of the games, so one attack and one defense. And if there will be need, we will go then to tiebreaker as well afterwards. So yeah, interesting thing. Guys, short reminder, we have just a moment before the game starts. If you have not yet placed your bet, exclamation mark bet on chat. And sorry, but it's too late actually. We are jumping into the game. I'm closing in the betting. And let's switch the screen. Let's see the game happen. Crash? No, okay, it works. Cool, all right. Sound is good, everything is in. So guys, Harbor City. We have Endgame there on attack. We have defenders in form of Pond Guard. So we will see how it will go. Endgegner, as we can see, mainly heavy armor. We see 4 short swords, 2 glaive players, poleaxe, and 2 mouse. Also 1 long sword have switched. But then also 4 medium armor. So that's interesting to see. 1 short bow. So we'll see if they will be focusing on players more. On the other end, for the Pond Guard team, we can see a lot of mouse. And this makes sense. In defense, you take someone with a maul and you just throw him out. That's a good idea. But also quite a lot of medium and light armor, 6 of those. So interesting to see. On the units, we see a lot of Armingers. This makes total sense to bring. Or maybe not a lot, only 2. And on Endgegner, there are actually much more. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 versus 2 Arminger Lancers. So Endgegner looking to bring it more to later stage of the game. If they will be able to push to the A without too much losses, and they can bring out all of these 8 Arminger Lancers versus 2 Armingers on Pond Guard, they can be very, very, very hard to deal with. Especially that this map has a lot of space, a lot of different routes, a lot of different small roads where you can flank, where you can hide, where you can run around and utilize those horses to flank someone from back. So we will see if this will be used to their advantage. For now, let's see where the opening of the map goes. We can see all the players loaded, so no remake this time. We had some problems last week, but right now, no problem. We can see opening trebuchets, very good idea. Opening trebuchets already to destroy the artillery of the defenders. I would like to remind you right now that there is no artillery at all. You cannot place any additional artillery. Only things that are already placed on map can be used. Also, on top, you can see here we have 13 trebuchets left because one more is flying in. You can also see units left and currently alive heroes. So, Pond Guard. In defense, they are playing very, very nicely, utilizing the whole wall. Each artillery is being occupied. They want to shoot as much as they can. They want to utilize them as much as they can, because this is only advantage artillery-wise they have. Attackers not only have the cannons and have hachas and whatnot, they also have 13 more trebuchets. So this will be quite crucial. We can see this artillery usage from defenders is very nice. Of course, it's much easier to shoot at towers because they are a very big target, but still, having those 2 towers destroyed will be very good from the time perspective for the defenders, right? Attackers have to wait right now for this tower to spawn. Attackers will have to push them once more, and this will lose a lot of time. We have seen this in Group B, where Lamaland were attacking, and they were at the cap point with a lot of units, but they just had this like 30 seconds more and they could win the game. Unfortunately, because they lost all the towers at the beginning, they couldn't do it. So yeah, this can be a crucial. We'll see if here in this matchup it will also be so important. We can see very standard placement from Pond Guard in defense. We can see a lot of units on this side of stairs. A another big block of units waiting to move and counter and get their moves on these stairs, and then we can see a small defense force with one person, LLL, here watching the small gate, which is right now being destroyed, and he also have support from someone else with the shield, so we can see Imperial Pikes and shield units over here. For other things that are happening right now on the battle, seems like this tower will be destroyed as well in the last moment. Very good, so we have very nicely from Torgadon, from Dealer of For Life, also from Ripcats, Muskets, Shortbows were shooting this tower non-stop, and they managed to destroy it very close. So this is going to waste more time than even imagined. So we will see if this will come up for Endgegner at the end as a problem. Gegner here not really pushing the small gate, they are just creating some pressure, but not too much. Other than that, they are waiting with their units. We can also see Longbow from Non-Numerical shooting down the units here, trying to hold the tower a little bit more. Magner and Gigut trying to protect them with their horses, trying to protect them with their bodies. They managed to do it quite nicely for most of the time. Here ultimate was used to stop it a little bit. From other direction, actually, Shortbow is also shooting, so they're doing good job. And look at that, they killed enough of Martellatoris to stop this tower of being pushed. Already so much time being lost on Endgegner. Very well played from Pongar. And look at that, not necessarily too many units were lost right now. We can see only 41 units lost from Endgegner, and so much time was wasted. Very, very well done. This tower seems like it's full health. It's also being pushed with stalwarts, so this is going to definitely reach to the target. But will Endgegner want to use this tower? We will see. Some teams want to go ahead from here and already broke the stairs. Some teams want to directly go to the 8 point. But this might... we'll have to see what Endgegner will decide. For now, another pike unit is coming to push here the tower. Gate, middle gate is also destroyed. So pretty much both gates destroyed. One tower in, another tower going to be also in a moment. And this third one also in like 20 seconds or so will be reaching the gate, the wall. So Endgegner, all openings are there for Endgegner. They can do whatever they want, wherever they want. They need to decide. And here they are slowly pushing in, and they are not seeing any defenders at all. This is very crazy what they are doing. Pongard, you can see they are doing something strange. They are giving up A point fully. Fully giving up A point. And at the end, when I thought about it a little bit more, it makes absolute sense. Guys, there is one advantage right now after the initial stage of the battle is finished. There is only one advantage that attackers have. This is trebuchets. Where trebuchets work great? On walls. You can hit everything on the wall. If Pongard would be defending on the wall, they could be crushed down with the trebuchets. For this move, where they moved down, they cannot be reached out. The walls are protecting them from trebuchet fire. They cannot do anything right now. And yeah, they are not losing any units. And considering how much time they were able to lose from with these tower moves and whatnot, they are in a good position to, you know, defend what they want. But we can see here a very problematic thing. Pongard right now have no one on top of walls to scout. And Endgegner notice that, and they are using this very, very good to do a full rotation. And this is what we talked about in the beginning. Many Armingers on the field. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 Armingers right now on the field. And Endgegner going to try to pressure the Pulas on the left side of the map. Let me zoom out a little bit on the map here as well, so we can see Pongard rotating a little bit late, because vast majority of the forces from Endgegner, they are already behind. And also there is one big thing for this plus. Attackers can use trebuchets very well on this point. They can clear out defenders very well on this point. And what they will do? Look at that. They are just utilizing their horses, running fully around. Full around. Look at that. No one is pressuring the plus point. This is a little bit problematic for Pongard, because they have mainly infantry units. They are slow to walk. They cannot rotate that fast. and we can see already Sharps player with spear on point with horses against defenders with no units at all. They are just having heroes here defending without any units. And very good trebuchets as well to close the rotations. Yes, some pikes were able to make it from pawn guard, but and stop Endgegner here. But Endgegner very wisely choosing to push with some forces on the plus, because yeah, they didn't play everything on one card. They wanted to split forces, and only problematic thing is trebuchets. Yes, they are going to use another trebuchets. One question: why so late? Why so late? They have still 11 trebuchets left. They could use it much faster and clear out the defenders here or in the main cup or whatever. We can see still 4, 5, 6 and Gegner players trying to put pressure on the cup zone, but Pawn Guard were able to defend their plus, were able to defend their cup point, and right now what we can see is they are crushing them from both ends. So this is going to be a bloodbath. Pushing from both ends, advancing, horses charging, everyone shooting, trebuchets flying around, trying to cut them off, but it was too late and too little. Good job with the Pawn Guard defense. Very last time, but did it well. And in the meantime, Endgegner took so much time and attention of Pawn Guard, no one was defending this plus point. Only Kreator is here with few units left, is holding up. He's very low HP, half HP only. Short sword, yes, hard to kill this guy, but with so many people attacking him, he's going to be dead in a matter of seconds. And this is plus point capture, the first plus point captured on this map we have seen so far from attacking side. So very well done on Endgegner. I wonder if this is what was planned. They wanted to just try to play aggressively on the back end, capture the attention of the Pawn Guard and fake the capture and then move to this point. If so, very well executed, very well done, very well played. And right now we are in a very strange stalemate where many things can happen. First of all, 10 more trebuchets to be used and 7 more minutes. A lot of time for Endgegner to be used on the push. We can see right now they are splitting their forces a little bit. Most of their players coming in with the via standard route to the main cap, but we can see some people are putting pressure here, Trilling and Mastiff on the flank with their horses, going to bring some attention of Pawn Guard to their end. We can see non-numerical, very well played, aggressive plays. He is able to spot and see all the Endgegner units moving forward. And right now we are in the stalemate corner. Let's zoom in a little bit down, see what will happen. For the statistics so far, 400 units left lost on Endgegner side, 200 on Pawn Guard. So Pawn Guard, yeah, 900 versus 1400 pretty much. 50% more units on the Pawn Guard. But if Endgegner will be able to do one precise aggressive push, this difference will not matter. Pawn Guard, you could have so much units, whatever, how many you want. If Endgegner will push you out, you will not be able to do anything. And we can see very nice use of Zykalian Militia. We can see very nice push of Stalwarts, also Fortebraches behind them, two units of Fortebraches, no, sorry, make it three. Counter Pikes advancing from Pawn Guard, but they are being destroyed very fast, considering two Zykalian Militias throwing from the back, burning down a lot of units, and all those pikes, holy moly, triple pike setup and triple shield setup, very well placed from Endgegner, advancing slightly, just meter by meter by meter, centimeter by centimeter, very well played. And yeah, seems like they cleared all of the units from Pawn Guard. Pawn Guard right now just few heroes left alive. They will try their best to try to defend here. Maximus being the only one on the point right now with short sword, trying to stay alive as much as he can. Remember that also Endgegner right now, they have trebuchets, they can cut off supplies from Pawn Guard if they will play it well. Pawn Guard trying their best right now, regrouped with some units. They are hidden behind this building, so yeah, not that easy for trebuchets to hit them. And we can see also some flank coming in from behind, but flank is being right now covered, so this is very good place. And yeah, only one player, Giotto, blocking the spawn. He's a spear player, not that much armor, not that much survivability. He's trying his best, and very well reaction from Pontgard. Yeah, after this first push and Gegner forces, they were in good shape when it comes to numbers, but when it comes to the health, most of them were very low on HP. And this allowed Pontgard to regroup, allow Endgegner, you know, to be a little bit over-aggressive, because Endgegner also tried to push a little bit forward. And then by just, you know, taking one player at a time and making him go and die at the point, but blocking the capture point, Pontgard were able to regroup, retake their units, form a flank, small one, but still, right? Flanks grabbing attention is still a good thing when it comes to reattacking some spot. And then, yeah, very well played on their end. But let's look at the stats right now. 7 trebuchets still left for Endgegner. We'll see if they will use them. 3.5 minutes left, so they will have to move past. When it comes to units, 550 left for Endgegner versus 997 for Pontgard. So pretty much twice. So very nice play with units on that, in that regard. When it comes to heroes, hero lives, we can see few people who died 2 times from Endgegner, few people, only one person who died twice in this Critoris from Pontgard. So very good on health as well. And yeah, this is going to be the last push. 3 minutes left. They will not have that much time left for many different actions. We can see Halabarders coming in. We can see some Namcans coming in from the attack. We can also see some shields, but not that much. And right now, Pontgard playing more aggressively. I like this. I like this very much because behind this wall, you can hide quite well from the artillery of the trebuchets. So they are eliminating with moving so fast, so aggressively, they are eliminating 2 things. First one, advantage of the trebuchets. They cannot use trebuchets that well. Second one is time. The more aggressive they play, considering they have twice the amount of units, the more time they waste from Endgegner, the better for them. And this is what they decided to do. Full push, full aggressive. Yes, trebuchets are flying in. Doesn't matter. Just don't die. Lose your unit. Try to take as much unit from Endgegner as you can, and then go back, take a new one. We will be golden. That's their idea. That is what I imagine they are right now talking on their comms. And very well executed. They, yes, many of them have died right now. 2 more have died from Pontgard. We can see only 9 people alive versus 15. So, yeah, this can be problematic if Endgegner will push aggressively enough. Considering they have 1 minute 30 seconds still, they can do it. They can push aggressively, and to be honest, with 200 units left, this is only thing they have left. Kind of a deathmatch. And yeah, if you remember Aritournament 1, Endgegner unfortunately lost the deathmatch. They were defenders at that time, but they lost the deathmatch at the point. Right now, they have much more numbers in terms of heroes, but not that many units, unfortunately. Trebuchets as well coming, trying to cut off the supply. And yes, they have more people. They are blocking very nicely. They are capturing very good on the point. But yeah, seems that Pontgard bringing in more units right now. They can choose whatever they want. They will be able to make it in time. Very well played. 60% capped. I think this is, yeah, this is the highest amount of capped end zone we've seen on this map compared to last week. But yeah. This is going to be end, unfortunately, for Endgegner with 170 units only left and 12 heroes. They will not be able to fight against so many units from Pontgard. Yes, these are mainly gray or green units, right? We have seen a lot of pike militia here. We can see also some halabarders, even some demise pikemen making it their way to the fight here. They are very numerous, not that strong, but very numerous, right? But yeah, so much pikes, so big blob of units. 5 seconds left, game over. Very well played from both teams. I need to take a short moment to drink something. We can watch the stats in the meantime. But yeah, considering how interesting the match was, the stats are reflected here as well very well. We can see Endgegner team, they played very, very, very nicely. They played together, they had a good plan, they executed it very well, and this is reflected in the statistics, where pretty much everyone from the team have similar amount of unit skills. There is not that many differences, right? About 70, yeah, the average is like 70 or 80 or something like that. But yeah, like from average, the top unit killed from Alpha, only 40 or 50 more, right? Below average, only 30 or 40 less. So very well balanced gameplay. On the hero kills, we can see 5 kills from Trilling, playing Spear. Spears, yes, very good at killing heroes. So yeah, very, very well played. On the other end, for Pond Guard, we can see Ripcats. I want to see what he played. I will rewatch the stream and the replays, because I want to see what he played with to make 200 kills. A lot of kills was done by this player, so congratulations. 120 next follow-up, so pretty much half, right? When it comes to heroes, 5 killed by Giotto, spear player, 5 by Payan, their team leader, and glaive player, very well played. So yeah, for the statistics, nice stuff. I don't want to focus on the post-game analysis too much, because it was, I guess you see what happened, right? 3 point A for free, very nice flank behind by Endgegner, capturing plus side, and then they tried to push the cap zone 2 times. So that's pretty much the whole game in short. But yeah, looking at how it went, I'm amazed, to be honest. Compared to what we've seen last week, the games were quite static. This time, much better. Okay, let's jump into the preparation screen for the next game. And yeah. Ooh, guys, I need to really drink some more. I forgot how hard it is to comment by your own. And why I am commenting by my own. Unfortunately, Pond Guard players, they are from North America. 2 of their players did not make it, have not woke up or something like that. Yeah, if you are from West Coast, you have like 6 a.m. So understandable. But yeah, they were missing 2 players. So my co-caster, CB, and German co-caster Samuel, they have joined Pond Guard to balance out 15 versus 15. Of course, Endgegner being very good team, and you know, nice on the team team spirit and so on, wanting to make this equal. They also said that they can make it, you know, 14 versus 14 or whatever. But yeah, co-casters coming into play very strong. Making it balanced 15 versus 15. Unfortunately, I have to cast on my own because of that, so it's not that easy. Okay, we will have next match in a moment. Let me set up a timer. It's gonna probably be like 4 minutes or so. I will look if there is a lobby open as well in the meantime. And yeah, guys, reading right now through the chat, I see a lot of people happy about the game. Yeah, Lolbrok, shout out to Primo Victoria and Vole. Sorry for my French, pardon, but yeah, shout out definitely. We see nice traps flying in, yes, definitely. Mishak, why this map was chosen into tournament? Actually, there were 5 maps which we could play in the tournament, and each team captain could ban some of the maps. So basically, out of 5 maps, 2 were banned, so only 3 maps were left, right? The maps which were left was Wolford, Kura Castle, and Harbor City. The maps which were banned was Daswofort and Valley Fortress. And yeah, how we choose the maps is by lottery, basically. Before each game, we do the lottery for the map, and this map was chosen, so that's why it was played like that. Yeah, I see a lot of hype on the chat for Payan. Onion juice. onion juice. No, it's a water mixed with apple juice, actually. So water mixed with apple juice. Guys, congratulations to PondGuard for winning the first game in defense. And we will be shortly swapping in teams. This time, PondGuard will be attacking and Gegner will be on the defense. So we will see shortly how it will go. Players are connecting right now to the lobby. Still few more missing, so probably they are making some changes, maybe changing some weapons, maybe changing some units. We are playing on tournament server. So this is very balanced, meaning that there is no doctrines, meaning that there is no runes. Everyone have exactly same equipment, no leadership bonuses, no bonus statistics on equipment, just pure gold, golden equipment for everyone. Units as well, every unit maxed out level. So yeah, equal opportunity for everyone to try their strength and compare who is better. Definitely, definitely good game. Okay, reading through the chat, I see a lot of hype all around. Yeah, maybe we can as well, as we are in the middle of the standard games, let's see the betting. Let me tell you that 82% people have voted for Endgegner to take the first place in the group C. 18 people have voted for PondGuard to take the first place. So quite a big discrepancy. And considering how well Endgegner, even if they lost, how well they played, yeah, they can be, they, this can be, this can be, this this can go both ways, I guess. Passy, please, no trash talk. Thanks. Yeah, unfortunately, Russian village boys couldn't make it. They have some holiday in Russia today as well, and they did not manage to get all the people to the tournament server. Not to the tournament server, but basically all the people to the game. So they have forfeit, and unfortunately we have only Endgegner and PondGuard playing. But yeah, with two teams only, this allows us to focus on these two teams more. And what we have seen from the first match, this maybe not worries me, but it makes me think how right now they will play. We have seen very different approach to the games from both teams. Endgegner, much more cavalry focused in the first game. Eight, if I recall correctly, eight horses versus two on PondGuard. And they used this to flank very well. I wonder if they would bring 15, would it make a difference? Imagine all 15 players with horses only rushing to the cap and blocking defenders with trebuchets. This could be interesting to see, but we will see what they will come up with this game. One issue I want to highlight from this game would be, I think PondGuard played too defensively, right? The idea to not die to trebuchet, not lose units to trebuchet, was very good. Give up A for free and not lose units to trebuchets. That's a good idea, yes. But not having anyone on the wall to look at Endgegner, what are they doing, to look at their rotation, this is something strange in my opinion. At least one player, like one short sword, right? Worst case scenario, what would happen? He would die? No, he would just jump down or something, right? So not that problematic in my opinion, but yeah, they played too defensively in my opinion at that part of the game. But yeah, right now we are going to jump into the second match. Thanks guys for the follow. We have Misha, we have Stormy Sanchez, we have Vurelius. Welcome. And yeah, let's focus right now on the match, guys. I will talk with you a little bit later. Yes, Koshpar, only two teams. Okay, so PondGuard. They have won their first defense game. Let's see if they will be able to do something like that once more, this time on the attack. they are bringing in once more a lot of light and medium armor sticks. So I believe this is the same, and the same setup with spears, muskets, longbow, shortbow. On the other end, and Gegner, we can see they are bringing in 5 medium and light armors in total, 2 spears, 2 muskets, and 1 shortbow. So I believe this is quite similar. One big difference is that Pondguard right now being in offense, they are bringing much less hammers, much less mauls, and we'll see where it goes. When it comes to the units, a lot of purple units chosen on both ends, it makes sense. Defenders, of course, with Zikalian Militia, very nice. And once more, Endgegner quite heavy on the cavalry side. Pondguard bringing in only 2 cavalry units, once more. So very similar play style when it comes to units. We can see just 3, I believe, yes, 3 Namkan units. I seen like 1 or 2 Zikalian Militia on Pondguard. So quite... I would say quite limited in their options, right? They have a lot of pikes, shields, halberds, yes, great, but not that many cavalry, not that many flanking opportunities, not that much arquebuses or archers, meaning not that much damage output in the long run. So we will see if this will be something that will be problematic for them at the end. And Gegner, in the units department, they are definitely much more balanced, bringing a lot of different units, more Zikalian Militia for the defenders. I mean, in the attacking side, also, and Gegner had like 2 or 3 Zikalian Militia, so very nice usage of these units we have seen in this tournament and from Endgegner team as well. But yeah, let's focus right now on what is happening. Standard opening, everyone using artillery. Short reminder that in this tournament you cannot place any artillery. Only artillery you can use is what is already on the map. And second thing is for attackers is trebuchets pretty much, right? So that's it. And we can see, yeah, some Hvachas cleaning down this village watchman for whatever reason. Probably they didn't have, yes. So Hvacha did not have yet the angle for shooting at tower. Right now it's focusing on tower. Okay, that makes absolute sense. And we can see 3 towers being pushed right now by Pondguard. We can see CB, my fellow co-caster, right now trying to create some pressure on the side, bringing attention of 3 and Gegner players. So very well played. Good highlight for my guy over here, running on his horse majestically, very nicely. And yeah, trebuchets cleaning up more artillery, and there is a big difference I can notice. Can you notice it as well compared to the previous games? The towers are moving forward. Yes, they are very low HP. We can see this tower is like 20%, middle tower half. Left tower is going to die in a moment probably. Yeah. Will it die though? They don't. It will, okay. They were shooting with Magner with shortbow. But yeah, Endgegner, much worse job with tower destruction. We've seen Pondguard destroyed each tower at least once, and some of them I believe even twice, if I recall correctly. So very well done on the tower department. Here for Pondguard in attack, bringing in middle tower. And this one also, I believe, will reach last. Oh, look at this. No HP. It's like 0 HP. What the... Nice. Very nicely played. 0 HP, but 2 towers are there. So no time lost. No single second lost from Pondguard. And they are going to bring a push here. So we can see a very different approach to the defense from Endgegner. They are going to fight Pondguard here on the tower. They are blocking them from both ways, having some players on left, some players on right, and trebuchets are flying in. This is what Pondguard wanted to not have, trebuchets on their face. That's why they decided like that previously to not do it. This time Endgegner aggressively defending, pushing forward. Very nice usage of Zikalian Militia. Look at that, fire everywhere, burning all the units. But this is going to be cleaned with 1 more trebuchet and very good advance from Pondguard. Namkans had to move, not too many died, that's great, but still quite a lot of units lost. and seems like the point will be captured. Two players here hiding with their units behind the cap zone. They were planning to make stop capture of the A point as much as they can, but unfortunately, Pond Guard very massively moved in and cleared them out. Are they going to cap it? No. Rainbless and Sustav are very close. Two heavy armors going to block it for as much time as they can. One more short sword. Eye novelty close by. Gitas as well. Sorry, Taz as well. Dr. Drgo as well. So a lot of players from Endgegner playing very aggressively here on the defense. And this pays off. Not too many units are there for the Pond Guard left. Meaning that Endgegner can just run around the point and survive quite long. And the trebuchets that right now Pond Guard are using, they are not that effective. They are not killing that many units. They are not killing that many heroes. So very, very well played. Different approach, but also well played from Endgegner. We can see Takeno as well blocking in. And yes, it will be captured. Unfortunately, he was picked out from the point by Petudi. So the point A was captured by the Pond Guard. And right now, let's see, only 8 Endgegner players alive. So if Pond Guard will notice this, they can try and rush the plus point. And it seems like they are going to try to do it. They have just few units, unfortunately, in the attack. And the defenders on the other end, yes, they don't have too many units either. They have just one shield unit and two pikes, one halabard, yes, and some Zikalia militia hidden behind. And seems like Pond Guard noticed that they already prepared their defense and they switched around, moved to another plus point. They are going to focus on killing heroes. One problem, and let's look at the stats right now, what might be in the long run for Endgegner is that they already lost quite a few lives. As you can see, 8 players died from... 8 players only died from Pond Guard, but 14 players died from Endgegner so far. 14 lives. There is limited amount of lives you have. You have only 3 lives per player, and we can see that already Papu, one left, so his last life is there, so he will really, really, really need to watch out on what he's doing. In terms of units, this is also interesting. 1,100 in Pond Guard and only 900 for the Endgegner. Most of this difference is coming from the cavalry, because on unit slots we can see it's quite similar. Endgegner having much more cavalry, they cannot have that many units in terms of unit count. Right now, we can see advance after advance after advance coming here in the middle from Pond Guard. They are trying to make their ground. Trilling here from behind with his counter advance. We can see as well some horses from Endgegner already moving around. And the timing for the horses is quite good because most of the advances are already done. Unfortunately, yeah, he lost most of the horses for the Forte Braccios, so he tried to do it as good as he could, but didn't manage to do so. And Pond Guard, look at that. They managed to win the fight in the middle. Very well placed pikes, very well staggered advances, not all at the same time. Nice cavalry, not too many because they bring 2 in total to the game and only 1 was used in this action. But so scarce cavalry, but very well used. I see some questions. Yes, this is the second game and the first one Pond Guard was victorious in defense, so they successfully defended the fort, even though Endgegner was quite close and they captured around 70% of the last cap zone. So very, very well played from both teams. Right now what we can see is Endgegner trying to put a defense in the standard spot. They have also Kennepower here watching the flank. We can see Takeno with horses also covering the flank and Trilling also horses waiting on the flank to see what happens. Pond Guard right now rotating heavily to bring as many units as they can to the front line, and they are going to harass a little bit the units in the front for a Gegner. Opening trebuchets, I don't think it will hit at all, maybe a little bit, but we'll see in a moment. Looking at the statistics before the last fight, 1,000 units left for Pond Guard, 600 lost, 800 left for Endgegner, 530 lost. So similar numbers. When it comes to lives of the players, 18 lives lost on Endgegner, only 10 lost on Pond Guard. We don't have a single person who died twice on Pawn Guard. We have already three people on Endgegner who are on their last life, so they need to watch out. And the attack is being prepared very heavy in the shields and pikes department. So seems like Pawn Guard want to do something similar what Nexus did in the group A. They wanted to go full brawl, no ranged units, not too many supporting units, just full on horse. Advances, pikes, shields, you know, brute force, brute strength. This is going to be interesting when compared to Endgegner, who currently have on the field one Zykalian Militia, so they are going to harass a little bit, and one Namkan Ergs. And the push is here. Push is here. We can see Guard coming in very far wide to try to flank out Endgegner. Endgegner counter rotating very nicely. This Trebuch not hitting anything, unfortunately. And we can see a Clash of the Titans here in the middle. Both teams are advancing. Look at this advance from Pawn Guard. They are kicking everyone down. We can see some cavalry coming as well from behind, trying to cover this flank. But yeah, seems like the amount of Forte Braces that Endgegner had on the field was just perfect, because they managed to hold down quite a lot of Pawn Guard offense. Unfortunately, this Trebuch will be quite crucial, cleaning down a lot of the units that are left, and cavalry coming in very strong after all the advances were finished, after all the pikes were dead. They just cleaned up the house, as you might say. Right now, Endgegner, double horse coming from behind. We'll see if they will be able to make it in time and try to help the main point from dying. 12 versus 8 heroes right now on the battlefield, so much more players alive for Pawn Guard. Unfortunately, they don't have too many units left. And Gegner, if you guys play this well with the horses, seems like you will be able to clear this out. All the units pretty much from Pawn Guard are down, and Gegner right now cleaning up the house. Look at that. Capture point is just slightly captured, is like 5% or even less, and a lot of people are dying right now from Pawn Guard running for their lives. Very well executed with the cavalry. I am actually quite amazed on how Pawn Guard did this, let this happen. They did not cover their back too well, and this cavalry in the back tactic is something which is very often happening on either sieges or on ranked plays. So yeah, right now Endgegner, as Endgegner do, very aggressively playing forward, trying to take as much time as they can from the Pawn Guard, and pressuring also their plus point, not allowing people who are alive to exchange their units, also creating pressure here on the gate, trying to clear units out from the people that are coming in to the battlefield. And this is something that is nice to see, because the unit count is quite similar right now. You can see 490 versus 400, so very similar. Heroes killed. This is something that's right now very interesting. Seems like Endgegner did overdo it. They took the plus point. Congratulations, but you lost all your players on the main point. And this is very problematic right now, because we can see 1, 2, 3 players from Endgegner already died 3 times, meaning they cannot respawn anymore. So Endgegner, 12 players max. Right now CB and Easy Peasy Baby rushing into the cap point, cleaning down, trying to clean down remaining units. Yes, they still have 4 trebuchets left, so they are trying to use it well. And Gegner right now rotating back and trying to defend it. They did not notice the trebuchets, unfortunately, and many of the Forte Braces died. What's fortunate is that this barricade is indestructible here, meaning that Pawn Guard, they cannot just run through the middle to the camp point, they have to go to either side. And right now, Trilling still in behind with his spear, with his horses, going to create a lot of pressure. We can see Mastiff here with novelty as well, coming in with Condottieris, creating pressure from behind. Gavinio also from the front with Dr. Drko. Very well cut for all the supplies. Pawn Guard, they are having different approach. They are moving most of their forces together here, as you can see, trying to just go through the wall of Endgegner, moving slowly but surely towards the cap. Not too many units left on either side. 300 versus 200. Trilling coming in to suppress with his cavalry all these Pawn Guard players. We'll see if he'll be successful. For now, he's just waiting. And yeah, Pontgard able to clean out many of the Gegner players, and only two are alive. If you look at the statistics, you can see on the right side, everyone from Endgegner who have three lives left cannot spawn anymore. They have six spawns only left and zero players right now alive on the field. So yeah, it's done, I'm afraid. The enemy is about to capture the final. My guys, we have noticed something that I thought cannot be done. Pontgard have managed to win this attack and managed to capture the fort successfully on the attack side. Holy moly. What an intensive game. Take a look at the stats. I need to take a short break because my dog is doing something strange. Stop the camera. Okay. Sorry for that minute of silence, but we can give this minute of silence to Gegner, I guess, who unfortunately lost both their games. Congratulations to Pontgard for winning both on defense and attack. Let's take a quick look at the statistics. From Pontgard, we can see three people over 100 units in form of CB. Congratulations, Toad King and Giotto. So very well played. On the other end, we can see Trilink, yeah, spear player, 10 kills. Solo handedly, of course, with his Armingers, he killed 200 units and 10 heroes. Guys, you have 3 lives only in this tournament. So this means each team have 45 spawn points total. He took 10 out of Pontgard. Amazing, amazingly played. We can see also quite a lot of unit kills on many of the Gegner players. Considerably, 6 of them had over 100 and 1 of them over 200. So very different. This comes from the very different approach to the units, I guess. We've seen that the Pontgard bring in, at the start of the game, they had much more units because they bring in pikes or units which had who have a lot of people in the squad, so that's where this numbers difference comes from. But yeah, very very interesting. And then yeah, Giotto, 12 kills. Come on, guys, what's happening here? He yeah, 3 more kills and he would kill the whole team. Right, so that's amazing stats. But yeah, also like, there is only 2 or 3 players on Pontgard who have not killed a single player, so very well played, very well balanced statistics all around the way. And yeah, that's all for the stats, I guess. When it comes to the post-battle analysis, this game was pretty much from first second very interesting and actually was very full of all the action. So in point A, Endgegner defended, right? They lost a lot of units to trebuchets, unfortunately. Endgegner didn't also manage to destroy 2 towers, so Pontgard were able to get up with 2 towers from the start of the game. But this allowed us to observe very heavy fights across whole walls around A point. So Endgegner team, they very well played with their heroes. They hidden even 2 of their heroes with some of the units behind the cap point. And when Pontgard thought that the A is clear, they moved away, right? They come out from their hiding and they killed a lot of units from behind. So very interesting tactics as well there from Endgegner. But definitely they were offensive and aggressive since first moment, and this was seen on the wall. A lot of units were dying at that point. So you can see here a lot of 3-minute mark, a lot of things happened. Then after that, Pontgard went down. There were a lot of fights in the middle, and at the end they managed to retake the plus point, move towards the cap zone, and a lot of fighting was happening in the cap zone. We have seen this many units died and many heroes that died over there in this one of the final pushes. After that, Endgegner very aggressively pushed away Pontgard back to their spawn, killed a lot of units, a lot of heroes there, but Pontgard managed to stick together with few of their heroes and pushed it to the end. So congratulations to the Pontgard team for winning both games. And yeah, welcome back, CB.
Yeah, thank you.
How did you like it?
Yeah, this was so much fun. This was amazing. I love it's so fun to see how they communicate within the team as well. Like, it's pretty on point, man. You can tell why they are a good team.
Cool. Yeah, so if you have not noticed, unfortunately CB was not here for the games because Pontgard unfortunately had to had two players who couldn't make it to the tournament. So both CB and German co-caster Samuel, they were invited to join Pontgard, and thanks to that we had a balanced 15 versus 15 match. Of course, Endgegner, they said that they can, you know, kick some of their players from the squad and make it even, you know, 13 versus 13 or whatever, but thanks to the help of co-casters we had even 15 versus 15 games. Very well played. And yeah, CB, what did you think about the games?
Yeah, it was interesting. Like what we talked about before the game, Pontgard definitely expected, of course, the Zekalia militia to come in from Endgegner. And I think you could tell that Endgegner expected Kev, right? Because they were, in the first game, they were really hesitant on pushing the towers. So it took a few minutes before we finally got hit with the siege towers. And yeah, that gave us a lot of time to talk about the strategy and stuff. So I think that was pretty interesting to see. And I think in the first game, the Kev rush for Endgegner was so interesting, right? I hope you had fun with that on stream. Mm-hmm. Because it caught us by surprise on the Pontgard team. But yeah, that was great, amazing to see. And then Endgegner got a great defense as well with the army guard in the back. Pontgard did expect that. They put up some Fort Brachios.
Mm-hmm.
But Endgegner still managed to get a great army guard defense on the final. So yeah, I think those two games were really interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
How was it on your side?
Much harder to comment alone. I got used to doing the co-commenting, so yeah. That's a bummer, but I tried to do my best. I had to drink much more water between the games, but yeah, I mean, very interesting games compared to what we have seen last week, where both teams I mean, I would say that these teams today and last week, the teams were quite equal in terms of strength, but the tactics and strategy, what they have chosen, that's totally different. Last week, what we have seen is similar tactics and similar like strategy. Yes, the unit choice was a little bit different here and there, some decisions and so on. But generally speaking, the clashes and the fights were similar. Over here, like the first push of Endgegner, like from your perspective, was it like, or how did you react when they all popped up in behind in your like cap with all the horses?
In the second game, you mean?
No, the first game when Endgegner was attacking and they popped up in your cap,
yeah,
like behind
the. So we saw them coming on the left side. Of course, they were coming over there with infantry, and then we noticed that they were gone. So we realized, okay, they're moving over. So already some guys started to move over there,
mm-hmm.
and then they were like, okay, they're coming through the gates with Kev, and they're rushing us. So it was really quick that they said, okay, we all go to the other supply set up there. And then we did get surprised that they even wanted to go for the final. So we didn't see that coming. Mm-hmm. I hope you got it on stream, but I threw some Zekalia militia fireballs.
Yes.
And stopped a couple of Kev. I was really proud of that. So yeah, that push was definitely surprising and how far Endgegner wanted to go for the final camp, I think.
Yeah, and they were quite close, right? I mean, of course, you Pontgard have reacted quite nicely with the rotation, but unit difference, right? Pontgard having mainly infantry, the amount of distance they had to walk was quite considerable, and this allowed Endgegner to outrun them with the cavalry. And at the first moments of the cap point, of the main point, what we have seen was like one or two Pondgard players with just units, with just heroes, versus like two or three Endgegner players with heroes and units. So this could go very hard, very fast, right? Very, very problematic. If you know, some of the trebuchets from Endgegner would land a tiny bit more accurately or something like that, and could cut off the supplies, this could be totally different fight. But yeah, very interesting. And then after that, the push, you know, if we'll be able to talk with the teams after the deathmatch, friendly deathmatch, you will see in a moment. If we'll be able to talk with the teams, I want to ask Endgegner if this is what they planned, and this was more of a distraction, because after that they immediately jumped down to the right side that is closer to the wall, plus captured it, quickly rearranged their units and moved to the final point with the heavy push, right? So this was very nicely executed. But we can talk about this and the second game in a moment, as we are jumping right now to the deathmatch. So good luck, CB, once more.
Yeah, I think I'll join, right?
Yeah.
We'll see. All right. See you in a bit.
Bye-bye. All right, guys. So, as you have heard, we have right now friendly deathmatch. For the day, Endgegner had unfortunately lost. Pondgard won the both games, even though they were quite close, to be honest. So, this was quite, quite interesting fight. Definitely well-deserved win from the Pondgard at the end. But right now, as we have only two teams, as every week, we are going to do some friendly deathmatch here with the teams, just for fun. And let's see where it goes. Let me unmute my game as well. And let me know in the chat right now, guys, have you ever seen something like that? 40 kills maximum, 13 versus 15 deathmatch. To be honest, I don't think I will comment it. It's just too many things happening right now. We can see a lot of muskets, a lot of shortbows, a lot of damage dealers on the end of the Pondgard. Also, quite a few damage dealers on the Endgegner side, but I guess, yeah, more heavy armor is on the Endgegner end. And seems like Pondgard will be able to take the top point, but no. Kenny Power, Magner, and the Baylas from behind coming in, putting the pressure, kicking out all the Pondgard from the top, and seems like at the end this is equal. Right now we have 3 versus 3 at the top of the wall of the tower here. Endgegner still staying alive thanks to their superior heavy armor numbers, and they will be taking the top right now. So we'll see what they will do with that. We can see that there is no artillery here on this map, just for fun. So pure damage pretty much all around. And the Pondgard looks like they are playing with a lot of short bows and a lot of musket players, and focusing up on one player at a time, trying to kill him as fast as possible and moving from one to another to another to another. You can see Susnov here on the back trying to kill. He managed to kill one of the guys, but he was quickly taken down as well. And looking at statistics right now, we can see leading with the kills on Pondgard, we can see Torgadon. And on Endgegner's side, we can see that we have Ravelas with 2 kills. 13 versus 6, so twice the amount of kills on Endgegner side. Sorry, the teams are other way around. Sorry for that. And now camera is gone. Great. Congratulations, I played myself. Stop with the mouse movement, please. Okay, so let me switch around the teams. Okay, now the team colors are reflected properly. Sorry for that, I was a bit confused by that, but yeah. Payan being taken down right now, and seems like Pondgard have taken back the top tower. Is it necessarily a good thing? I don't think so. If I play on that match, I often use shortbow, and to be honest, I prefer to fight on the equal ground, so not being above or beyond below someone. I prefer to fight with shortbow on the same equal height. So this tower is something different, and we'll see where it goes at the end. Seems like Pondgard still continuing with this killing spree, having 22 kills versus 9 of Endgegner. seems like they are going to right now to win. We'll see if Endgegner will switch some weapons, will switch some tactics. Of course, this can be done during the game. You can, when you spawn, you can select different weapons as far as they are the same armor, right? So you cannot, if you have heavy armor equipped, you cannot choose light armor weapon, but other than that, yeah, you can switch around. And we'll see if they will adjust something. For now, 28 to 11, almost triple amount of kills coming in from Pawn Guard. The amount of damage they have brought in with the muskets, with the short bows. I mean, the short bow doesn't have that much damage per se, right? Especially against heavy armor, but he has a lot of poison, a lot of stuns, a lot of staggers, and whatnot. And with that approach, they can keep people down very, very, very long. So let's see here. We can see us being down once more. He stand up, he's down, he stand up, he's down, and he dead. Pretty much that's how hard it is to fight against such a spam of the short bows. And they are doing the same right now with the sharp player. They are right now focusing on Takeno. Now they are switching their focus to Rabelias, and they are going to kill him in a moment. And they are moving forward up, and we will see who will they try to focus. Pian with a very good grenade, killing one person and moving out a few people. But yeah, close quarters. Novelty fighting here, Takeno as well, trilling with his spear. They are trying their best, but 36 to 17, there is just 4 kills left for Frontgun to win this deathmatch. We'll see if they will be able to do it. And yeah, 2 more left. Will be dying here. Seems like Ripcats will be dying. Candle power also very low. Dead. And the battle is over. Yeah, very very interesting game. Very fast. Very heavy on kills and very heavy on action. Hard to comment something like that. Sorry for that, especially if I'm alone. So yeah. Three Frog saying that shortbow is the highest DPS ranged class in the game. Maybe yes, maybe not. In my opinion, depends. It depends on the situation, because musket have very high piercing damage and piercing armor penetration. So versus heavy armor, musket, if he's being able to hit headshot after headshot, he can deal massive damage, but it's very hard. Shortbow damage per second is very very good, yes, and you can hit much more often. So it's also, if you can hit 100%, I would imagine that musket is bringing more damage, but you cannot hit everything. So yes, that's why I use shortbow as well very often on the deathmatches. That's exactly the reason what you're writing. So let's just say we're both right. Joshimo, yeah, the deathmatch is not tiebreaker, actually. The Pawn Guard team have won both battles today, so there was no tiebreaker required on the field map. The deathmatch was just for fun. Unfortunately, one of the teams from the group today once more have not been able to participate. So basically, we wanted to give you a little bit more content, stuff to watch and to comment. So that's why we have the deathmatch streamed here. Okay, and I can see CB is back. Hello, CB. How are you doing?
Welcome back.
How was the deathmatch?
Yeah, this was so much fun. I didn't realize they were going full range until I was in the battle, because it was a bit late. But mm-hmm. this felt like Counter-Strike or something.
Yeah, with so many players, like at the first few minutes of the battle, I was like, yeah, guys, you just watch. I will not even talk on it. It's just too much 13 versus 13 deathmatch. It's just too much things happening. So
yeah,
hard. So hard to fight. And I imagine it's even harder to play, right? Because you have people coming from each direction, mm-hmm. arrows flying from everywhere, and grenades flying everywhere and whatnot. So
yeah, especially with how many muskets and shortbows did they play, like 10 or so?
I didn't count. I mean, Endgegner team had much more heavy armor than Pawn Guard, but yeah, there was in total there was like let's say tons. Let's agree on tons of
yeah,
muskets and shortbows. So a lot of stones, a lot of poison flying around, a lot of bombs and whatnot. So interesting.
We definitely abused the high ground on the middle for sure. With all the range, that was fun for them. I hope it was fun for Endgame as well.
Okay, so let's get back to the second game, right? Because before the deathmatch, we were able to discuss the first game a little bit, but the second game. Because you were in attack.
Yeah, so let me think back, right? Because it's going so quick now. Yeah, so for the attack, it was quite quickly that they already decided they weren't going to play a full cav, which, right, they definitely wanted to, but they just allowed their best players to bring the cav and look for opportunities. So that was already a different strategy, because they realized that they didn't want to get caught without infantry units not being able to cap A. So they knew that the traps was going to be important, and I think on the first attack, Pond Guard was struggling a bit with the left side overpushed a little bit too far, and then the right side got caught for Pond Guard by Endgegner, and then we had to regroup. So that was that was a bit of a overplay or too aggressive play there for some players in the team, but after that it was a quick regroup, and then the game went on. What did you think about the first attack? Because you had the overview, you saw more about what was going on. I think Endgegner made great use of Sicali and Misha again, some other units as well.
I mean, for the second battle, the initial attack was very interesting, right? Because as I said during the stream, first battle, Pond Guard, I am pretty sure they said, okay, we will not lose our units to the trebuchets. Let's give them A for free. We already have bought so much time destroying all the three towers, right? So that's what I imagine happened. And then second game was totally different in that regard, because both, I believe, middle and right tower were able to reach. Or was it middle and left were able to reach? And immediately, Pond Guard were able to jump into the attack. And that's something different from the previous one. On top of that, Endgegner play style being very, very, you know, they like to fight pretty much. So they took the fight immediately. And this had some pluses and minuses. The main drawback, I would say, is the amount of heroes they lost, actually, right? Because they fought till the end. They had some nice ideas. They implemented a tactic where they even hidden two players behind the cap zone. And when the Pond Guard was very low on units and that, you know, didn't even think someone was there, they just ran out and basically were able to keep A for like another 1 minute or something like that. But in the long run, from the positives, I would say that the main one was that they played it well. So it's not like they got stomped or anything, right? They immediately jumped on one tower, right? They had a nice intelligence, like scouting players. They knew where there are more people and where they are not. So they properly sized their forces to given flanks. And they were aggressively not allowing the Pond Guard to take the good position. They wanted to keep them as tightly as possible for these Zikalian militia grenades to fly, as well as I believe there was two units of Namkans supporting them. So very heavily, much heavier on the firepower support from Endgegner on that side. So definitely very nice, very nicely played. And trebuchets, the initial ones, like two or three, were very hard hitting, and Gegner lost a lot of units because of them. But next ones, when there were not too many units left on both ends, Pond Guard even lost these trebuchets. They placed like two or three trebuchets just for three units or one hero, and they didn't even hit him, right? So this could be crucial in the long run. So we'll be having an interview in 1 minute.
Yeah. And also I can agree, like, being in a battle is so different, I can tell now. when you have the overview read. So definitely it felt like Endgegner was putting up really good fights in the second battle. It was a back and forth, I felt like. And it was also that, they, like you said, they wanted to keep fighting. You could see that at the end, Pontgard was ahead in a couple hundred units, I think, compared to Endgegner. And Endgegner had quite a bit of Armigers out on the field. And you could see that they were pushing Pontgard, trying to kill more and more units. And it almost got them to a deathmatch at the end of the second game, because there were so few units left. But Pontgard quickly realized that Endgegner was out of, I think, 5 or 6 players, because they died 3 times. And I think that actually made the difference in the end there, because that also, of course, took away some of Endgegner's players.
Yeah, all right. So let's jump into the interview. We have all the casters here. Hi, guys.
Hi. Ari, you're muted, yeah.
Yeah, and Professor Alucard as well.
He's completely muted. He can't hear us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I'm pinging him to unmute. Okay, and Samuel, maybe you can tell us in one sentence, how did you like the participating in the games in the meantime?
It was really fun. It was really funny. I already spoke about it in German, in German cast. So the people were relaxed and sleepy. They told us about it. And they gave us the call what we should use. But Sabai, for example, said, I'm good with Glaive. I want to use Sicalia. And they said, yeah, okay, you can do it. No problem. So they were really chilled out. And they had a plan in general. They had a plan, like they said, we will let fall A immediately, then we will split up on the 2 supplies. So in general, there was a plan, but then everything was reactive to the enemy.
Okay. So I guess we can ask them directly, as we have Payan here joining us in the interview. So I will invite him now. Welcome, Payan. Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Congratulations on your back-to-back-to-back victory, I guess, because the deathmatch for fun was also the victorious.
Thank you.
And if you could introduce yourself and shortly, and your team, sure, if you wish.
Okay, yeah, so I'm Payan. I am the team leader of Pontgard. And at first, most of us are from the house, the Wolf Syndicate, and we're part of the Heavenly Kingdom Alliance. And we started off playing the tournament for fun. Actually, our first tournament was the first Aritournament, so that was our first tournament ever. And that was really fun, too. And now we're taking it more seriously because we're more into it, we're more invested. So it's definitely very fun, and I appreciate you guys hosting the tournament.
Thanks, and let me tell you, it's definitely visible that you are taking it more seriously. This performance that we've seen today with all the viewers, I mean, it's purely amazing, considering that you were taking on Endgegner, a very good team from EU2. They have won multiple objectives on territory war. They also participated in multiple tournaments, ranking there very highly. First question I would have to you is, what do you think about the Endgegner in general, like playing against them today?
Oh, definitely a good team. The first strat they did on their offense, I never seen that before, going through the back side gate and all the way around our spawn area. Like, that was really unique, and I've never even seen that before, so that caught us off guard. We were scrambling, rotating, and it turned out okay for us in the end, but definitely later they also had some really good pushes. And they caught us off guard with a treb around the corner at home on one of their last pushes. So a few times it was super close, and you can bet I was shouting, like, get on point, you know?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, definitely. That was very, very interesting thing to watch as well and comment. And about this strange action, or maybe not unusual play from Endgegner, After seeing something like this in the first game, did you change something in your tactic and your plan for the second game, or you went with what you had prepared early? So did you adopt?
Yeah, I think we still went with our main plan. To be honest, like, we're taking, like I said, we're taking it more seriously, but as far as planning for this map, we did it very basic because we didn't want to plan for like every single situation, offense and defense of three potential maps. So we're like, we'll keep it simple, standard play style, try not to get everybody confused. Because that's how we lost some tournaments before. We tried too hard to make a strategy and it's just too complicated, but we stuck to more simple tactics this time and just pushed as a team, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. CB.
Yeah, I got a question, Bjorn. I love playing with you guys, first of all. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thanks for joining us.
Yeah, sure, no problem. I put in the numbers in the second game as well, so I think you were happy with me.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, great. So we know, if our schedule is correct, that you will be playing Lamalands next week. In 2 weeks, of course, in the quarterfinals. Have you watched any of their games, or and what do you think about facing them?
I do not know anything about them, so I guess I'll be doing some research later.
Yeah, you'll have to. They showed some interesting games last week.
Okay.
Yep.
Have those been uploaded on YouTube?
Yeah, you can watch those on General Combo's YouTube stream. They're all there.
We'll yeah, I'll them. Check that out for sure.
Yeah,
I'm gonna do some research.
All right, good. Yeah, so you faced quite a few teams, of course, in the tournament scene, right? What teams so far do you think are really good from EU and NA that you faced?
Definitely the first one that strikes out is Eden, because I think they're the only teams we've. Oh, and we lost to Aclarities last week in the core tournament. That one was closer, though. It was more close than in terms of points, because the core tournament has a different tie-breaking system with the battle points. But Eden definitely strikes out to me. They definitely play very well as a team. And we had one game where we, like, our last person held on home for the last 3 seconds and barely won, but we still lost pretty far in margin of battle points. So props to them for sure.
Yeah, interesting.
Cool.
Yeah. We could definitely see Aclarides getting better, right? I think they lost the first few games that they played, but then against you, they got the surprise win, I would say, for sure. So.
Yeah, definitely. And they, I mean, props, like, I'm not blaming the scoring system at all, but they did a good job. What happened was, like, 15 of them all stepped on the cap point, and that's, you know, the rules are the rules, and we're not complaining about that, but they definitely played well within what they're supposed to do, and that's why they came out on top. And that's really good of them to do. And we messed up on our end. We should have been a little more prepared. But yeah, props to them.
Cool. Okay. So Ari, Toshima, and Samuel, any questions from your guys?
Well, no question direct, but I just wanna say thank you that you played even with 30 players, and I had to fill you up with Bergliebe. Well, to that question, did you think that you would had a better, have even more better games if you had your two team core members of the squad today?
I think it would have been probably about the same. I mean, our two fill-ins, Bergliebe and CB, did great, so I'm not complaining at all. I mean, I don't think two people of seemingly equal skill level probably would make a big difference, but yeah, I'm happy with what we had.
Yeah, after all, it's a team game, right? So
yeah, and they sense. Like the two sub-ins really communicated well and did great.
Indeed. And we have also Professor Alucard, our Spanish caster. So are there any questions from your end?
No, man. Like I said before, GG, man. You're the first team in the tournament that won back-to-back, I guess.
Yeah.
You're literally the first team. Yeah. So congratulations on that.
Yeah, thank you. And also, like, I mean, those two matches could have went either way. We did win really hard at units on the first battle, but they got pretty close to capping, and that was really scary. So, like, it doesn't matter how many units you have left if you all die and give up the point, which we almost did. So those games could have went either way for sure.
it was that push that got the guy with the trap. They killed like 5 or 6 heroes in one trap, and that made the whole difference. Yeah.
They killed a lot of units, and then some of us were like, oh crap, like my units are red, should I go heal? It's like, oh yeah, go heal real quick, and then they push, and that caught us off guard for sure.
I have to say that was probably the best trap I saw in a tournament. In any tournament, that was a freaking amazing trap.
Yeah, we probably should have prepared a little more or just known about it, but like I said, they did a good job making sure they catch us on our mistakes.
Yeah, and watching this from the top, actually, indeed, as you said, at the end of the first game, I believe Adrigner had like 70% of the capture point done, and this could go either way. And I was considering if they would bring even more cavalry to this push and not bother even with the plus, but just go full ham on the last point. You had, at this point of time, you had only infantry, which is quite slow, and a lot of fortebraccios, for example, and the slow infantry, right? Did you, or whoever is the shot caller in your team, if you could give us a voice com, like a reaction, was it calm, or was it like, oh my god, the we are burning, or...
Yeah, definitely. Well, props to Maximus. He was our shot caller. I think everybody was shouting to get on point and bring whatever we had because we were scrambling a bit. Most of us got wiped. I'm not sure exactly. I think definitely more than half of us died on that big push. And then the rest of us are trying to hang on. And I think we hurt them enough where our respawn with fresh units was able to push them off. But yeah, we all got back just in time.
Yeah. Definitely. Yeah, so as said, congratulations to your victory today, taking the first place from the group C. You will have to indeed rewatch some of the games of other groups to prepare as well as you did today, I guess, for the next quarterfinal games. Those will be best of three, so a little bit different. We will see how it goes. And yeah, if there are no other questions.
No other questions from me, man. GG, that's it.
Cool. No, just GG from my side.
Yeah, GG.
GG indeed.
Yeah, thank you guys for casting and hosting and sharing all this. This is really fun. I love it.
Thanks for coming, man.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
All right, thank you.
Bye-bye.
All right, bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Okay.
Yeah. So I believe it will be... it will be all. So CB, hearing this interview, can you confirm was it indeed a bit of a scramble with this strange horse situation that Endgegner pulled off?
Yeah, maybe it felt like that for them, but I felt like they were really calm. It's the same like Bradley was said. They were a really chill team, I can tell now from being in the inside. So I felt like they didn't really stress out, at least not in their communication, which is great mm-hmm. for a team, I think. But it definitely, they were like, oh, they're going there. Oh, no, they're going there. Oh, no, they're going there. Go, go, go. So it definitely built up, right, the anticipation.
Mm-hmm.
So, I can imagine that it felt for him, of course, being the team captain as well, you have more responsibility. So, yeah, might be true.
Yeah, it makes sense. And I mean, at the end, it's also a bit different because you are just here, a guest at their team, you know, just having some fun, right, while they are fighting for... the glory, right, and the privilege to, you know, be the first in the in the tournament and so on and so forth. So yeah, could be also a little bit different in the emotion side and whatnot. So
yeah, absolutely. And I already joked about them. Maybe I'll join them in 2 weeks with their team again. But I don't know. I love this team that we have going on as well, and I would really like to watch those matches from above. It's I feel like they were so amazing.
So, season 8 CB top ranked NA player confirmed.
Yeah, maybe I'll transfer over to NA. Yeah.
All right. Cool. Okay. So I believe this is all for today. I mean, we had interesting matches. We had an interesting switch of events. Unfortunately, two of the guys from Pondgard were not able to make it. So we had our Beloved CB and German co-caster Bergli Samuel also joining, right? So we had even 15 versus 15 games, and yeah, both games won by Pongard. Congratulations once more. Then we had a nice and interesting 13 versus 13, hell of a death match, and yeah, that's all, I guess. Next week we'll be starting probably this same time, so 3 p.m. And what are the teams next week? CB, do you have a sneak peek for us about that?
Yes, I do.
From what I recall, it will be Goblins, another American team. Never seen Takimi. This team, I don't recall which server they are from. And we will have Crippled Squad, which is EU2 team. And big sneak peek from my end. This is actually my house, guys. So I know they train and prepare quite hard. So going to be interesting for me personally. How about you?
Yeah, quite so. Yeah, I think next week is going to be really interesting. I hope we're getting three teams, right, for the final group would be great. Set for a third team, of course, to have to leave it, but they would still be able to battle it out. So that would be amazing. I'm really looking forward to Goblins. They're kind of similar to Pondicard in their style, being an NA team as well. And the other two teams we don't really know too well yet. I'm not sure if we've seen them in another tournament. I don't think so. So yeah, definitely another interesting group. There might be big surprises. I hope Royal Legion from EU2, that I know also quite well being on the server, is showing up. We know that they have good players. So let's see how they fare in the tournament scene. I'm really curious. Next week is going to be fun. And then, of course, we know our quarterfinals and how exciting is that going to be, right? We've seen amazing battles so far. It's only going to be better in the quarterfinals.
Yeah, and I mean, what you pulled off today, right, joining the team, maybe I should do something like that next week, and we just join my house, yeah, but I guess it's not working like that, fortunately or unfortunately, we will see, but yeah, cool, okay, that's all from us together today, I guess. We'll take a short break in a moment, then in a minute or two, we'll be doing a lottery, because I believe when I watched last time at the betting, only 18% of people have voted for Pondgard. 82% have voted for Endgegner that they will win. So only 18 people. This is gonna be hell of a lottery with two people to choose from. So we will see how it goes. So nice. Taking a short break, and we'll be back in a moment. And CB, any last comments from your end?
Yeah, see you next week, guys. It's going to be even better. Keep coming back.
Cool. Bye-bye.
Bye. Hollywood perfect. Hollywood perfect. Somehow I woke up out in Beverly, fucked up, smelling like that bourbon. But I end up alone, I'm not certain. The girls impolite in the club every night. Somehow I woke up out in Beverly. Perfect. I'm cutting dice. Look at these eyes. They're not here to please.
Hello, back. We are back on live, and right now what you can see on your screens, guys, is the yes, you can see that we had 11 people who entered the betting. As said earlier, 82% on Endgegner voted and 18% on Pondguard. Moving on to the responses, here you can see everyone who have voted in. And I need to hide my camera for a moment. Yep, here are all the people who basically did the predictions as such. So we have Spunky, Frodo, and Vanblade who have selected correct teams. So I'm copying in the players right now, and we are going to move to the Lag Tools tool I'm using, and I'm adding manually these two people. So very interesting, 200 sovereigns. Let's see who will win today. Fifty-fifty chance, guys. Interesting lottery. I think this is the closest we had ever in all the tournaments and all the lotteries I did. 50-50. And a short reminder, you don't need to confirm. I'm asking for your Twitch ID, as I will be sending this to Vanblade, I guess. Why not? Congratulations, Vanblade. Both of you guys had a 50-50 chance to win, and we have a Vanblade who have won. So guys, first of all, congratulations to Vanblade, right, for winning the prize today. I will not require the countdown what I did in previous tournaments, because right now the delay is a bit longer. So last time we had some issues with this delay. Right now, no need for that. I will be sending the prize to Vanblade then. Congratulations to both the teams who fought today, right? Pondguard advancing as first, but Endgegner also advancing to quarterfinals, so they will still be playing in 2 weeks. Yes, so next week we have Group D playing, the last of the groups, and then we are going to play with the quarterfinals. So as you can see on the screen, here are all the dates. If you don't know them, you can right now screenshot them or whatever. Group D, next Sunday, same time. All welcome to join. We will be playing, hopefully this time there will be three teams. If not, then yeah, we'll be playing some dead matches for fun and then some additional content for you. And yeah, so far, in all three groups, so Group A, Group B, and Group C, we had three teams in each group. Unfortunately, one team of each group were not able to make it due to different reasons. So basically all teams that played so far are going to advance to quarterfinals. We'll see if Group D will be different. Hopefully we will see much more fights. and much more interesting content, because games today, oh my god, were very interesting. Yeah, Spanky, Frodo and Vanblade, they see exchanging their very nice comments around. I have added as well, yes, I have added as well new command to the chat, exclamation mark history. I have put it right now on the chat. You have here YouTube playlist, and over there you can see all the replays from the previous games. I uploaded all the content from group A and B, the whole thing, as well as cut down separate matches and interviews and all this interesting content. Everything is uploaded over there, as well as Aritournament 1, because many of the teams that you can see in Aritournament 2, not all of them, but quite a lot, are also or were also playing in Aritournament 1. If you are interested in any of this, you can check the link I have right now posted on the chat, rewatch everything and so on, no problem. And exclamation mark help as well, if you write exclamation mark rules or whatever, there are links to our official ARI tournament Discord where you can exchange information about the tournament, you can check any updates, you can be the follow the latest information about the tournament, about the teams, about everything pretty much, and so on. So don't hesitate to join. And yeah, that's all from me today. Thank you very much. Have a nice Sunday. In Poland, we actually have tomorrow a day off, as well as there is one more holiday day. So gonna take some nice break. And yeah, if anyone is interested, my health is also getting a little bit better. I'm still having some final tests this week, but hopefully next week I will be able to get some coffee in my system, be more hyped up, and moving on to the tournament, we will be having much more emotions from me, because from the teams, emotions are like up there, or even I would have to start like over there, like two floors above. So can't wait for more of this content to come. Thank you very much, and bye-bye.